Okay, and all right, so let's go ahead and get started. The target verse that we're going to be looking at is this verse right here in Matthew chapter 22, verse 14. Let's see if I can get that to post. Okay, Matthew chapter 22, verse 14. For many are called, but few are chosen. Now, I know we've seen this verse a number of times. I remember when I first looked at these verses, it seems to make a lot of sense, right? Many are called, but few are chosen, and we're all familiar with that. But when I began to look at each one of these words separately throughout the rest of the Bible, there are a couple of other verses that began to shine through, and I was able to learn some additional information just by looking at these words. You know, again, this just goes to show that the Bible itself is a very rich book, and nothing is in there by accident. So every word is really, really should be looked at in light of the whole Bible. Okay, so many are called, but few are chosen. The word many, this word here is the Greek word polus, and it's used like 365 times in the Bible, and it's translated actually 210 times translated many. Now, the basically what this study is going to try to reveal is, now we know that sometimes people are called. As a matter of fact, a lot of people are called. They become a part of the body of Christ. But unless they themselves have been chosen by God, they remain under the wrath of God, right? And let me just go ahead and get a couple of verses on here. But really, the focus is going to be understanding how God is using the word many in connection with the unsaved, and more specifically those who are unsaved within the corporate church, right? And as far as the word few identifies with the elect, with the believers. But let's take a look at a few verses. Matthew chapter 4, verse 25. There followed him great multitudes of people from Galilee, from Decapolis, from Jerusalem, from Judea, and from beyond Jordan. And so we see basically that as far as Christ's ministry, he always had a lot of people following him, right? Which is basically what we have today in the church. Even outside the church, you have all these ministries that claim the name of Christ. They claim his name, but does that mean that they belong to him? That's a different matter altogether. Matthew chapter 7, verse 13. Enter ye at the straight gate, for wide is the gate, and broad is the way that leadeth to destruction, and many there be which go in thereit. Matthew 7, 22. Many will say to me in that day. Now, what day is that? We've come to understand that this is the day of the Lord, right? Strong's reference 2250. In the New Testament, in the Old Testament, it's referenced 3117. And that is almost always identifying with our day. Yeah, with Judgment Day. Okay, so many will say to me in that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in thy name? And in thy name have cast out devils, and in thy name have done many wonderful works. Now keep your eyes on this word many here very, very carefully. And we'll begin, Lord willing, perhaps to see why it is that it is God Almighty who has written the Bible. Now, the Matthew chapter 9, verse 10, and it came to pass, as Jesus sat at meat in the house, behold, many publicans and sinners came and sat down with him and his disciples. And as I said before, we're going to see that for the most part, the the theme of the word many, God is using that word to identify it with the unsaved within the church. And we saw in the other verse that right away God is already using that verse in connection with whom? The publicans and the sinners, right? Many publicans and sinners. Matthew chapter 9, verse 37. Then saith he unto his disciples, the harvest truly is plenteous, that's the word many, but the laborers are few. And what harvest is Christ talking about? Doesn't the Bible teach that the harvest is the end of the world, right? The harvest is the end of the world. And even at the end of the world, the harvest is plenteous. There are a lot of people. But as far as the laborers, those that are chosen, they happen to be just a handful. They happen to be very, very few, right? And commentary on this last verse here. Let's look at Matthew chapter 13, verse 17. Well, verily, verily, verily I say unto you that many prophets and righteous men have desired to see those things which ye see and have not seen them, and to hear those things which ye hear and have not heard them. And this idea that many, okay, which is identified with the unsaved within the corporate body, they desire to understand the Bible. But in other parts of the Bible, God does tell us, such as in 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 3, but if our gospel be hid, it is hid to them that are lost. Them that are lost. Now, we know the church is lost today because God the Holy Spirit is no longer operating in the church. And we're going to look at some other verses here and perhaps get a better appreciation for the word many. Matthew chapter 19, verse 30, but many that are first shall be last, and the last shall be first. Now, how can we understand this passage? Right? Can we apply that today to what's going on insofar as the part out, separation of the wheat from the tares? Because if that's the case, then who is it that would be the first that become last? Wouldn't it be the corporate church, right? They had access to the kingdom of God throughout the New Testament. They belong to Christ, and you know, God refers to the corporate church itself as a rich man, and that it possesses many riches. But we know today that these riches God is doing away with, and so they were first in a sense. But now, because God has turned the tables over, they've turned out to be last. They are outside of the kingdom. And for the most part, those who actually were killed during the first part of the tribulation, when the church was so lifted up that they believed that now they were able to make the rules, and God allowed that to happen for a short time, and now God is turning the tables over. It is those who were killed, now they happen to be first. And the corporate church that had killed the two witnesses, the church becomes last. And Lord willing, as we continue to look at other verses in the Bible, either through this study or other studies, perhaps we can begin to appreciate that even more, and understanding this nature of those that are first becoming last and vice versa. And so that's what we see here, Matthew 19:30. But many that are first shall be last, and the last shall be first. Matthew 24, verse 5. For many shall come in my name, saying, I am Christ, and shall deceive many. Right? And that second many there, I do believe it is the exact same reference. The word many that we're looking at here. So today there are a lot of people, and God identifies them with the many. They are the unsaved. That's the corporate body. And when I talk about corporate body, I'm not necessarily talking about the organized churches. I think the Bible is could support the fact that anyone who claims the name of Christ, if you happen to claim a relationship with Christ, whether or not you belong to a church, you may not belong to a local church, but you do belong to the corporate body. And we're going to see that in the next couple of verses. Alright, Matthew chapter 24, verse 10. And then shall many be offended, and shall betray one another, and shall hate one another. So can we see how... Hang on a second. Well, before I get to this part, what about this idea, you know? How can we explain... Let's see, did I post this verse? Many shall come in my name, saying, I am Christ, and shall deceive many. Many will say to me in that day... Okay, that was Matthew chapter 7, verse 22. How can we understand? I mean, do we see the churches and congregations today? Are they saying, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in thy name, and in thy name have cast out devils? Because, you know, as some people, when we look at these verses, we're thinking that this is going to be a literal time period at the end of the world when Christ comes, and then you have those that are going to claim that they had a relationship with God. But I think that the way to understand these, because we have to, these passages tie in to the depart out, and we have to realize that God wrote the Bible in parables, right? And we have to understand everything in the light of the whole Bible. So even though a lot of times God will give us some verses and it appears as if there's a conversation taking place, such as the rich man and Lazarus. So God gives it, he gives it to us in a form of a conversation, but we should not always think or believe that this is a literal conversation that's going to take place at the end of the world. Okay, now getting back to Matthew chapter 24, verse 10, and then shall many be offended, and shall betray one another, and shall hate one another. So this hatred, right, we know that it has to be within the realm of the churches and congregations today. Because what happened when the body of Christ killed the two witnesses? It's because the animosity began in the church, and remember Jesus said that they shall put you out of the synagogues, yea, the time cometh that whosoever killeth you will think that he doeth God's service. So I believe that even that hatred that it's talking about here is a reference to the first part of the tribulation. Then shall many be offended, and shall betray one another, and shall hate one another. Body of Christ is called to have peace. It's called to harmony with God, right? But when the churches and congregations turned out and they killed the two witnesses, then there is division among the body. Luke chapter 7, verse 23, blessed is he whosoever shall not be offended in me. So we can see here that those who are offended, that identifies again with the unsaved, the corporate body. The believers are not offended, but the many here, seeing how God is using that in connection with the unsaved, we can see how that would relate. Matthew chapter 24, verse 11, and many false prophets shall rise and shall deceive many. The false prophets, they rise from within the congregation and they deceive the congregation. Many teachers, many pastors, they come out from the sea, from the world, and that is a reference to the corporate church, and it is within the corporate church that the false prophets, they deceive many. Matthew chapter 24, verse 12, and because iniquity shall abound, the love of many shall wax cold. What is this love that God is talking about? I think we understand from the Bible that it is a love for Christ, right? Those who identify with the people of God, those who identify with Christ, they have a love for God that translates into faith, translates into action on their part, not an action for them to become saved, but rather an action that identifies them with Christ as being the Savior. And we see that 1 John chapter 5 verse 3, "For this is the love of God, that we keep His commandments, and His commandments are not grievous." Matthew 26:28, "For this is my blood of the New Testament, which is shed for many for the remission of sins." Now that's a surprising verse, because if we looked at that verse and not really understanding how God is using the word many, we would think that this is a reference to the believers. But here God is using this word in connection with the corporate body. Christ, the Bible speaks as Christ going to the cross to establish the churches and congregation, the corporate body. And thus we can understand why many are called but few are chosen. But even in this passage here, we see how God is giving us the picture that the blood is shed for many, right? And I don't think that that's a reference necessarily to just the true believers. We have to read that in the light of the whole Bible. We know that out of this group, out of this multitude, there's only a few who do become saved. Mark chapter 5 verse 9, "And he asked him, what is thy name? And he answered, saying, my name is Legion, for we are many." Can we see why God would use this word many again in connection with the demons, the legion, the devils? Because they are the ones who identify with the unsaved within the corporate body. Acts chapter 19 verse 18, "And many that believed came and confessed and showed their deeds." Now we look at that and we're thinking, well, if anyone believes, then it means that they've actually become a child of God, right? But we know that the rest of the Bible will not support that, and so we have to begin to look a little deeper and see why God has given us this word believe here in connection with many. Luke chapter 8 verse 13, "They on the rock are they which when they hear receive the word with joy, and these have no root, which for a while believe, and in time of temptation fall away." And what is the temptation that God is talking about here? Does this mean that is this talking about someone who received the word of God and then they go home and somehow the family is upset and now they have tribulation? And I mean, I used to look at that and think that this is what, you know, these verses are talking about. And yeah, Althea, you're correct. It is a reference to the tribulation. Ultimately, that's what God has in view. They believe for a while, and in time of temptation, fall away. Well, this is exactly what's happening today, isn't it? With the corporate church. So we have those who believe during the New Testament church age. Remember, let both grow until the harvest. And it's at the time of harvest, I will say to the reapers, gather ye first the tares, and bind them in bundles to burn them. So we know that at any time during the New Testament church age, we have the tares that were growing right alongside the believers. And so they are the ones who believe. But now, because of trial, because of temptation, because of this tribulation that has come upon them, now they fall away. 1 Corinthians chapter 16, verse 9, "For a great door, an effectual, is open unto me, and there are many adversaries." 2 Corinthians 2:17, "For we are not as many which corrupt the word of God, but as of sincerity, as of God, in the sight of God, speak we in Christ." Again, very, very careful choice of words by God. And we can see how beautifully that these verses would flow and tie into other areas of the Bible. And James chapter 3, verse 1, my brethren, be not many masters, knowing that we shall receive the greater condemnation. Now, when I first saw this verse here in light of the way God is using the word many, this should really shake someone up. Because we do see today that there are a lot of people who take up the sword. They bring the gospel. They'd like to be identified with Christ. And yet here God is saying, listen, be not many masters. It's very important that God has used this word many here in connection with this, be not many masters, because what happens to those false teachers and prophets? Because the word many here is identified with them, that's where they end up. They begin to be identified with those who are still under the wrath of God. 2 Peter chapter 2, verse 2, and many shall follow their pernicious ways, by reason of whom the way of truth shall be evil spoken of. Shall be evil spoken of. 1 John chapter 2, verse 18, little children, it is the last time, and as ye have heard that Antichrist shall come, even now are there many Antichrist. Now, can you see how some people, they look at the word Antichrist and they come to the conclusion that God has to be talking about a person, an individual, such as Hitler or anyone else. But this word many here again is tying Antichrist to the unsaved within the corporate church, right? And the church is under the authority of whom? Under the authority of Satan. Satan takes his seat in the temple. And so all of this activity is identified with many Antichrist. 1 John chapter 4, verse 1, beloved, believe not every spirit, but try the spirits, whether they are of God, because many false prophets are gone out into the world. So we see the false prophets and the Antichrist is really one and the same, isn't it? Right, it's one and the same, and they both identify with many. Okay, let's go back again. Let's take a look at Matthew chapter 22, verse 14, and take a look at the word called. Many are called, but few are chosen. Romans chapter 1, verse 1. Paul, a servant of Jesus Christ, called to be an apostle, separated unto the gospel of God. Was Paul called? Yeah, he was called, right? Was he chosen? Yeah, he was chosen because the rest of the Bible tells us that he was a child of God. Romans chapter 1, verse 7, to all that be in Rome, beloved of God, called to be saints, grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, that verse there, that statement, beloved of God, called to be saints, is that enough information to tell us that these saints, those that are called to be saints, are really chosen? Are they a child of God? Not necessarily. We have to look at additional information in the Bible to see whether or not this is so. Romans chapter 8, verse 28, and we know that all things work together for good to them that love God, to them who are the called according to his purpose. Now, looking at this verse here, would this be a reference to the true believers? And if so, why? I don't have the reference to the word love here, but I do believe that that passage would identify with the true believers, right? Romans chapter 8, verse 28. Simply because God is using the word love here in connection with that. And I do believe that it is the same reference to the word love that we looked at. It is a love for God. It is a love that identifies the believer with the Lord Jesus. Yeah, I think so. And to them who are called, now even though these are called, we know by the context that they also have to be chosen. So to them who are the called according to his purpose. So ultimately, what are the things that work together for good? Well, you know, the Bible promises that God would never leave the believers nor forsake them, right? Nothing shall separate us from the love of God. And so therefore, these that are called, if all things work together for good, again, that's another indication that God has in view here the true believers. 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 24, but unto them which are called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ the power of God and the wisdom of God. Jews and Greeks, in connection with the word called, is that talking about both the believers and the unsaved? Yeah. Right, Althea, I see you're picking up on this, and I agree with you. Because we also know, and I didn't take the time to look at the word Greeks here, but I've seen similar passages in the Bible where God makes reference to the Jews and the Gentiles, right? And the Gentiles identify with the unsaved within the churches and congregations. And the Jews, they are the true Jew is one who is circumcised and who is identified with Christ. But again, we can see here that just because God is using the word called, he is not necessarily talking about the true believers. Unto them which are called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ, the power of God, and the wisdom of God. Now we have to understand that prior to the separation, prior to God bringing judgment upon the corporate church, God was really interested in the corporate body, wasn't he? Because it is the body of Christ. Christ went to the cross to establish the churches. And so whether or not someone actually did become saved, God recognized them. There are a lot of teachers, pastors, every Sunday they would come to the pulpit and they would deliver a message. But do we know whether or not they were actually saved? Well, we don't know that, but God was using many of these individuals, and a lot of them, I would tend to imagine that they, some of them, or perhaps a lot, I don't know, that they're still in the church. And again, that's not an indication that they're still unsaved. It could be that at some point God might decide to bring them out of the church. But we can see, again, the idea of being called a pastor, a Bible teacher, anyone in the church could be called. But whether or not they're chosen is a different matter. All right, Revelation chapter 17, verse 14. These shall make war with the Lamb, and the Lamb shall overcome them. For he is Lord of lords and King of kings, and they that are with him are called and chosen and faithful. You see how God is careful to give us the word chosen here right alongside of this? Because already in the context, we know that this has to be talking about the true believers. They are called. They're not just called, but they're also chosen. All right. And the word few is the Greek word oligos. That's only found actually 43 times in the New Testament, translated few about 14 times. But the context that we're going to see some of these passages here, really, this is talking about the true believers, right? We saw that earlier, that I think we looked at a passage here or there that had the word few. Let me go back and see. Yeah, that was Matthew chapter 9, verse 37. Then saith he unto his disciples, the harvest truly is plenteous, but the laborers are few. And so we see here in Matthew chapter 7, verse 14, because straight is the gate, and narrow is the way which leadeth unto life, and few there be that find it. Matthew chapter 15, 34, Jesus saith unto them, how many loaves have ye? And they said, seven, and a few little fishes. Now here's the bonus question. Who is the fish identified with? And we talk sometimes in this room about 153 fish, right? So we see that, yeah, that would identify with the believers. Remember the 153 fish that were caught in the net, and in one account the net was not broken, right? And here we see that God is talking about seven. They had seven loaves and a few little fish. And the purpose of this here, I believe, Christ was about to, what? He was about to multiply the loaves and the fishes, right? So again, would lead us to believe that this is a reference to the believers. Because as the gospel goes out, and Christ is the Savior, he came to seek and to save that which was lost. And so the few identify definitely with the elect. Mark chapter 6 verse 5, and he could there do no mighty work, save that he laid his hands upon a few sick folk and healed them. So we see that this healing is a picture of salvation. And the few folks that are in view here is a picture of those who actually do become saved. So we can see how beautifully God again is giving us the picture of the few as they identify with the true believers. Luke chapter 13 verse 23, then said one unto him, Lord, are there few that be saved? And he said unto them. Now, I don't know about you, but I think if I were going to ask a question, I probably would not phrase it the way it is phrased here in the Bible. But I'm pretty sure, you know, again, this is an indication that God Almighty is the one, is the author of the Bible, because he knows how the word few here is being identified with the believers. Are there few that be saved? And of course there are few that be saved, right? And that few identifies with his people. So the way the question was worded is very very well crafted, so that also would identify with the believers. 2 Corinthians chapter 8 verse 15, as it is written, he that had gathered much had nothing over, and he that had gathered little had no lack. Who is it that gathered little? Well, that would have to be identified with the true believers. And I think the way we probably could understand this passage, I'm not sure if it would altogether identify, but those who, I think this might be along the same line as the rich man and Lazarus, and also the verse that we looked at earlier about the first being last and the last being first. So we'd have to dig a little bit deeper into that verse to see whether or not the idea of gathering, what that identifies with, right? And so those who ended up gathering little, they had no lack. And that, of course, given the context, would have to identify with the people of God, with the true believers. 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 20, which sometimes were disobedient, when once the long-suffering of God waited in the days of Noah, while the ark was a-preparing, wherein few, that is, eight souls, were saved by water. And we see that even in the account of Noah and his family, they turned out to be a picture of what? A picture of the believers. That's the few. Now we have to think about that for a minute, because I'm not sure exactly how many people existed in the days of Noah at the time of the flood. But can you imagine? Here you have a whole world and eight people end up on the ark. Right? That's very, very significant. That really says a lot about those, or how many people are actually becoming saved in the world. Only eight people. And God is referring to these individuals as a few. They identify with the true believers. But again, if you try to analyze that and maybe do a little bit of statistics, It'd be interesting to see out of how many people that these eight individuals turned out to be. In other words, what is the percentage of the total population? That would be something perhaps interesting to look at. Alright, and so we see that that identifies with the true believers. Revelation chapter 3 verse 4, thou hast a few names in Sardis which have not defiled their garments, and they shall walk with me in white, for they are worthy. And that again identifies with the true believers within the church. Now the word chosen is the Greek word eklektos, used only 23 times in the New Testament, and it's translated elect 16 times and chosen 7 times. Let's take a look at just a couple of these verses before we close the study. Titus chapter 1 verse 1, Paul, a servant of God and an apostle of Jesus Christ, according to the faith of God's elect. That's the word chosen. And the acknowledging of the truth, which is after godliness. 1 Peter chapter 1 verse 2, elect according to the foreknowledge of God the Father through sanctification of the Spirit unto obedience and sprinkling of the blood of Jesus Christ, grace unto you and peace be multiplied. And now this is the one word that when we look at it in the light of the target verse, many are called but few are chosen, that we don't have to ask the question, right? Because anytime we see this word used, we know that this is identified with the true believers. 1 Peter 2 verse 9, but ye are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a peculiar people, that ye should show forth the praises of him who hath called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. That's the true believers. A royal priesthood, because when God's people become saved, they are kings, right? Kings and priests, as we read elsewhere in the Bible. 2 John chapter 1 verse 1, the elder unto the elect lady and her children, whom I love in the truth, and not I only, but also all they that have known the truth. So another word here, the word elect identified with the word chosen. What about the children? What about the children? Wouldn't that also be a reference to the true believers, right? So both would have the believers in view. Because, yeah, I think so. First we have the believers. We know the New Testament church started off with the apostles, and then the body of Christ began to multiply from there, and people have been coming into the body ever since. And so I believe that would be a reference to those who become saved through the sharing of the gospel as believers bring the gospel into the world. Okay, so that's the last verse here, 2 John chapter 1, verse 1. And I told you this was a pretty simple, easy study, but nevertheless, I would like to offer a conclusion just to make it official, right? And that conclusion would be, now it does appear that a person can be called, identified with the body, and God may even speak of the blood of Christ as being shed for them. However, unless that person was predestinated, chosen by God to salvation, he or she is still identified with the many that are still unsaved within the corporate church today. So Lord willing, if we learn anything from this study, is that when we continue to study the Bible, we run into this word many, We have to look at the context very, very carefully, because just the word alone could perhaps begin to raise additional questions about other passages in the Bible, and maybe even shed some light on some of these other verses. Okay, that's it for this study. I'm just going to turn off the recorder, and then we can chat just a little bit here. Give me 1 second.